Welcome to the Moduli class. What you have seen Okay, now it should work. I hope you can hear me. Welcome to the Moduli class. As I already told you in the mail I sent you this morning, we'll talk about more about phylogenetic trees and construct some of these and classify them. So this will be now much more concrete, and I hope it is fun for you. And just a small word on the video you have seen before. This was a double pendulum which is installed in a museum nearby the Forschungsinstitut Oberwolfach. And it is made out of steel, very heavy. And so you see the dynamics of this double pendulum is chaotic. No? You have a big, one big rotation which was white and a small one red. And the trajectory of the endpoint of the red bar describes a curve which cannot be given in closed form. And the interesting thing, of course, the video is of bad quality, but the interesting thing is when you see it in reality, it almost stops. But then again, it takes on velocity and moves very quickly. So it's very fascinating. I wanted to have such a pendulum also in Vienna for the university, but of course it's quite expensive and difficult to build. Okay, so let me start. So some people told me that it might be worth to resume again what is the situation, because it's one gets easily lost in the notation maybe. So let me start with a kind of recall where we are, and then we will jump directly into the trees. Okay, so we are on December 14th. So where are we? So we have strings, which are denoted bold x, which were vectors of n-gons, indexed by triples. So this was an element in P1 n times n over 3. And xt was xt1 up to xtn, a vector, an n-gon in P1 to the n. And I identify P1 always with the field and an element at infinity. So this is an n-gon. And we don't look at arbitrary strings. We look at strings which are in a set which I denoted by yn, script yn, p1 to the n, n over 3. And the elements, so the element x in yn, will be those strings whose n-gon xt have the same cross ratio. So cross qxs equals cross qxt for all triples st in n over 3 and all quadruples q in n to the 4. Recall the notation. So we distinguish between triples and quadruples. And now, what does this mean that the cross ratios are equal? Let me emphasize, we wrote, I also denoted the cross ratio by brackets. So if we have z1, z2, z3, this is a cross ratio of, now in terms of variables, of four variables z1 up to z4, and if we require that this is equal to the cross ratio like this. Now, as variables, we know what how the cross ratio is defined. These are two fractions, no? But we multiply the denominators in order to be able to substitute for the variables points in P1. So this will mean, and I write it down in detail because we will need it later on, so this means z1 minus z3 times z2 minus z4 times w1 minus w4 w2 minus w3 equals z1 minus z4 z2 minus z3 w1 minus w3 w2 minus w4. So let's taking now, of course, one instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, a quadruple Q, which I will write I, J, K, L. Okay, then we get equations in this big space P1 to the n times n over 3. And we have a whole bunch, a huge amount of equations. So it looks maybe a little bit difficult to approach this yn, but we will see that it has a very precise and exact description by simpler equations because we can eliminate here in this system of equations, many are redundant, and we will construct later on a minimal system of such relations, okay, and equations. So what does this mean here? If we now substitute for the variables, and I will do it without extra notation, then we see the following. If let me, how shall I run? Yeah. This, of course, makes sense for all. This can be evaluated. At any points. Now, these are just four tuples, z, or maybe, yeah, w in p1 to the 4. But there's an interesting fact, namely, if among the zi, three are equal, if, for instance, z1 equals z2 equals z3, then something strange happens, because then this one will be 0, this vector, and also this one. So then we get 0 equals 0, and this is redundant. So whenever, of course, here I write the same letter for variables and for points in P1, whenever 3 are equal, we don't get any equation. If 2 are equal, but these are different to z3 and z4. Now what happens here? Or maybe I take z3, that's easier to see. 2. Okay. Now this means that this first factor here is 0, but these two here, z1 minus z4 and z2 minus z3, they are non-zero. So as we have 0 on this side, we must have here either w1 equals w3. Okay. So this means that the same entries, you have equality between the same entries, no? Or, and now this opens a new door, it could be that w1 is different from w3, but w2 equals w4. Okay? So now we get an ambiguity. And this will be very relevant when we consider limits of strings, of generic strings. Okay? So you see, so we get either equality of the same entries or of the complementary entries. Hence, equality, in this case here, equality of same entries or of the complementary ones. Okay. Just hold on a second, my pen is running out of liquid. I'll be back. Okay, I'll try it with green. So now we will define a kind of bookkeeping for this situation, a definition. We take an n-gon, x equals x1, xn in p1 to the n, an n-gon. And what we want to keep track is which entries are equal. So we define the incidence set partition of n, which is our set of labels, I already did this, so I will write this maybe, what is a good, let me write it like this. It is a disjoint union, ik equals capital N, disjoint. So please distinguish between set partition and partition of integer numbers. We consider here only, set partitions. Yeah? And ij collects those I in N for which xi takes the same value. So that's not a precise definition, but you understand what I mean. Okay, so this is when we have just one n-gon. Now, if we have a whole bunch of n-gons, so if we have a string x equals xt, t in n over 3, then we can do this for each t. Get a set of incidence partitions, namely it, t in n over 3, where it is, of course, the incidence partition of xt. I will do an example in a second. So now we have many partitions of the set capital N. Okay, so we call this, maybe I write it like this, this collection of partitions, t in n over 3, this will be the incidence pattern. Of x. Okay. Now, of course, if we have the generic string, and if the cross ratios are equal, then all these will coincide. But in the non-generic case, we will have different incidence sets for different xt. Okay. So. What is clear is if xt is equivalent to xs, this was this is a stronger condition than having the same cross ratio, then it is clear that it is the same as is. Okay? Because the PGL2 action defines automorphisms on the space of n-gons. Okay, this is clear. Now, we will prove later on that actually we will have also the opposite. Yeah? That if the incidence partition are the same, then we will have equivalent n-gons. So that's already a hint that these partitions play a decisive role in studying orbit spaces or moduli spaces. Okay. Now I need one more definition. We say that XS and XT share a complementary incidence set if there exists I, so there exists a decomposition of the set of labels in two sets, I and J, with I is in IS and J is in IT. So they are not the same sets, they are different, they are just the complement of each other. Okay, and we will see this immediately in an example. Let me take XS, now we take n equals 6. We take XS 0, 0, 1, infinity, infinity, infinity. And we take XT 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, infinity. So, of course, here it's easy to see IS, we have three sets, of course. We have 1, 2, then index 3 is a singleton, and then we have 4, 5, and 6. And IT is 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And 6 is a singleton. Okay, and we see that there's this would be here I, and this would be J. There's a unique pair of complementary incidence sets. Okay, and this pattern, of course, that's a very simple example, but you can imagine how this works. Okay, and let me recall that these here, these are called singletons. Okay, any questions so far? So it's a little bit of terminology and notation, but I hope that you get quickly used to it, and it's not very difficult, and we will see that once we play with it, it's quite convenient and easy to remember. Okay, so now let me recall also what is a phylogenetic tree. We saw it several times, but phylogenetic tree, gamma with n leaves in a label set, n of cardinality. Small n is an undirected, unrooted, finite planar graph without cycles. Maybe you want to call them loops, and no multiple edges. And the key property, and no vertices of degree 2. For which the vertices of degree 1, so recall, the degree of a vertex is the number of edges going out of this vertex, for which the vertices of degree 1 are each decorated with a distinct label from n, maybe label I. Okay. So we distinguish, we have seen already many examples, we distinguish between inner vertices will be degree at least 3, outer vertices will be called leaves, this will be the one with degree equal to 1. And of course, saying all this is, of course, that we have a tree. So clear. Yeah, we also have a, maybe I should add here that we don't allow edges between leaves. No edges between leaves, which is a corollary of the one before, okay? So I think it's clear what it's meant. So maybe I draw this again. So in green or blue, the inner vertices, and then we have, so here at this vertex here, we don't need a leaf because it already has degree 3. This already has degree 3, but it could be that we have a leaf here. And here we can have, we have at least 2, but we could also have more leaves. And then we put the labels 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. Okay? So you will immediately see that we have a kind of classification of these phylogenetic trees. So the generic tree, is just one vertex and n leaves. One, two, three, n minus one, n. Then we have something what we want to call bamboo. A bamboo is precisely what you imagine. The inner edges just have one string, and then here we have at least 2 or more. And here we need at least 1 in order to have degree doesn't matter, and then maybe we have two. Okay? So a bamboo just means that any inner vertex is adjacent to at most two inner vertices. Okay? Inner vertices adjacent to less than two inner vertices. And then we have one more. Maybe I can spare space and do it here. One which I don't know how to call. I call it for the moment acute. And this means that the degrees of the inner vertices are exactly three. Degree inner vertices equals three. So here you see this one would have degree four, and this one would have even also degree four. Okay? So that's not completely precise. I think I want to have. So we have two types of degree, because it depends whether we count also the leaves on the red edges or not. And so here I mean the inner degree. So I can give you a drawing. We have always just, these are also called it bifurcated. Yeah. And then you have an arbitrary number of the leaves don't matter here. Okay. In the literature, these are also called bifurcated trees. Okay. Now, this looks easy and even boring. But there's much more to it than one would expect. Of course, this is pure combinatorics. So let me give you a couple of exercises you may want to try on your own to get a feeling how these phylogenetic trees work. So, exercise one, choose three leaves of your phylogenetic tree. For any three leaves of gamma, so maybe we choose here this one, and this one, for any three leaves of gamma, there's a unique meeting point. Is a unique meeting point. So what does it mean, a meeting point? A point, if you take the path from this meeting point to the three leaves, they are disjoint. I repeat, the point, an inner vertex of the graph, so that when you go to the three selected leaves, then you never go on the same edge. So here, if you, this one does not work, because to go from this one to one and five, you would have to go here together. This one, for the same reason, does not work, because going to one and five, you would have a common segment first, and then you only bifurcate. But this one is OK. This one here is the meeting point of the encircled leaves. because you have to go in three different directions to reach these three leaves. Okay? So prove it, and of course, do it in a nice way. Yeah? Not very difficult, but it's at least a nice exercise. Exercise two. This seems to be quite hard, the second one. Count for any n the number of phylogenetic trees with n leaves. But of course, I don't want to distinguish trees where the ordering of the labels is changed. So, up to permutation of the labels. So we looked up the Sloan's website of integer sequences, and we did not find for this case a formula. So there are several messages in the chat. Just a second. What is acute vertices? No, acute inner degree of inner vertices equals 3. Ah, so sorry, this was maybe too small. I'll try to write a little bit larger. Please speak out loud when you have a problem, because I cannot check the chat so easily. So it seems that there's no closed formula for this, for the generating function. We have already saw the case n equals 6 and n equals 5. We did examples, okay? The next exercise is for those who like to to work with graphs. So we will use it later on, but it is clear that you can modify graphs by deleting leaves, by deleting edges. You can cut the graph by deleting one edge. You could contract an edge. So I leave it up to you to think a little bit about define contraction and extension, or if you want, insertion of edges. Cutting off of leaves. So when you cut off a leaf, you may have to contract an edge to get again a phylogenetic tree, and then also cuts across edges. So you can compose one phylogenetic tree into two if you delete one edge, leaving the two endpoints. Okay. And just think a little bit about it. What would be reasonable to do here? Because it turns out that when you do the study the moduli space of endpoints on P1, then these processes will give you a structure theorem about the moduli space. For instance, writing the moduli space as a Cartesian product or contractions of moduli spaces and so on. Okay. Now, let me do a small lemma, an amusing small lemma. So, gamma, a phylogenetic tree with labels capital N. And so I denote the inner vertices V, W, and so on. Okay. And the elements in the label set I will always reserve these letters for them. Okay. So for each V, now I will define a set partition of N. Let IV denote, let me call it the travel partition of N associated to V. So let us take here V, maybe this vertex. Maybe I draw it again. Here we have V. And then we have our leaves. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2. 1, 2, 3. So what does this mean? What is this travel partition? Very easy. Think of this as a train station or as a rotunda. Train station or rotunda. In Spanish, rotunda. This is a crossing of streets, okay? So you have, from starting at V, you have four options. You may go to east, north, south, and southwest, or something like this, okay? And whenever you go one edge, you will be able to reach a certain number of leaves, and you take them in a bag together. So let me see if this works. So if you go here with yellow, you will collect all these here, okay? If you go with blue, you will get these two. And now I'm running out of colors. If you go with green, you will get these three. And maybe orange works. Now I take violet. That's almost it. Not a big difference, but okay. I don't write down the definition. I hope it is clear what I mean. Okay. So there's again something in the chat. Maybe it's rotunda. I don't know. You know what I mean. In any case, it doesn't matter. So we get a set partition of N, and we have the following property. Then, number one, we have at least three sets in this partition. Number two, second property, that's now the interesting one. Whenever you take one of these destinations, let me call the labels which are in the common set the destinations, for all I in IV, if you take something which is not a singleton, there exists a unique W in a vertex, and there exists a unique J in the travel in the travel partition of W, such that I disjoint union J is N. We will come back to this property in a moment when we prove it. And the third condition concerns the singletons for all I in N. There exists precisely one V in a vertex, as always. I hope you can read here, so that the singleton I is in the travel partition of V. Okay. So let me do this in the picture. So proof. We do proof by looking at the picture. And maybe you can see it yourself. That's kind of obvious. Now, any vertex has degree, any inner vertex has degree at least 3. So you have 3 directions to go. Here also, you have this one and you have these. Here you have degree 4. So that's clear. You get at least 3 different partition sets. Of course, they could have be some of them, those for the leaves are just singletons, okay? And the last property is also easy because we see that each leaf is just attached to one inner vertex, a unique one, and every leaf is attached. So let us look at this one. So for instance, let me take for I, so let us take the same V, okay, and let us take this set I here, the yellow one. Okay, that's one of these travel sets. And we are looking for an inner vertex which has the complementary set as a travel set. So the complementary set, I will draw it dotted, is of course all the labels here. And it's easy to see that W must be this vertex here. Going along this edge, you will just arrive at the complementary leaves then when you go opposite. So this condition 2 describes the adjacency of vertices. Yeah. So by inspection, just look at the picture, and the remark is that V and no, that's not good. I'm running out of space. Maybe I write it here. The unique W will be a neighbor of V. So here, this is a neighbor of V. Okay? Where do I write it? I don't know. Neighbor or adjacent of V. Sorry for the mess. So we have proven this lemma. And this holds, of course, in general. So what about the time? Yeah, maybe I make a short break here so I can erase everything. You can think about this for a moment. And then we proceed with these phylogenetic trees. So 5 minutes break. There's an ongoing discussion in the chat, I just realized, so about the meeting points and about the loops. So first, a tree does not have loops or cycles, okay? And what is the meeting point? I don't want to write it down, but I can tell it to you again. So you have a couple of, you take 3 leaves, yeah? And you're looking for an inner vertex which has the following property. If you take the simple path from this vertex to any of these 3 leaves, the paths don't share an edge. I repeat. So starting at this meeting point, you have to go in 3 different directions to reach the 3 leaves. So if I can show you here again, this one would, for instance, be, no, I had already had, this is a meeting point of this leaf, and this leaf. Now, if you take these 2 leaves here, you see my finger, I hope, and this one, then the meeting point is here. Yeah, because that's where you bifurcate three times. Okay? So, formulated differently, there is a completely natural concept and definition of meeting point, and you will find it yourself. Just think about it, what it should mean. Yeah? So imagine three persons sitting at the leaves you have selected. And then they say, let's meet. Yeah, then they will try to meet in a way that everybody has no part of his path common with another one. Okay. So there's a more interesting question which does not appear in the chat, but which concerns this lemma. This lemma tells you, especially part two, it tells you that whenever you have such a travel partition, then you define for every V all its neighbors. Yeah? So this is now the remark I want to write down. Condition. Defines adjacency. Adjacency means that there are just one edge between the inner vertices, between inner vertices. They share a complementary let me call it travel set, inside the set of labels N. You agree? That's now a key point. You have I disjoint J equals N. And the picture was the yellow cloud and the dotted yellow cloud. But once you see this, you get immediately the following corollary. The lemma is not just in one direction, it is also the opposite. So the next remark is properties, conditions 1, 2, and 3 give an equivalent definition of phylogenetic trees. As sets of partitions of N. So there are many different characterizations of phylogenetic trees, and one is through partitions. Yeah? Because as we already know what the vertex set is, yeah, we just have to know what the edges are, and the edges are given by adjacency. So please think about it. I don't want to carry it out in detail, but we can use also these three conditions. Okay. You can also look for further characterizations of phylogenetic trees. There are at least five different ones. So now I want to, how shall I say it? I want to switch topic. And and we come back in 5 minutes to the phylogenetic trees. And we recall what a stable curve is. Recall an n-pointed stable curve of genus 0 is a union of rational smooth curves So if you don't know what the rational curve is, it's just think of P1s, but you are allowed to curve them, of P1s meeting transversally, so without loops, without loops. I will make a drawing in a second, but you don't allow three curves meeting like this. Okay, that's forbidden. No. Without loops, together. So meeting transversally means that they meet like this, of course. Yeah? Not, no tangencies. Together with n marked points on the components. And outside intersection points. Such that each component carries at least three special points. I hope you remember, special means either intersection point or marked points. So let me make a drawing. So these are our P1s. And so you see clearly the intersection points. I have to put some marked points in order to have the condition of it, these three special points. So this component has two intersection points, so it needs at least one marked point. Maybe I do it in red. And then here I need at least two, but I take even three. Here I also take three. On this component, I don't need one, and I don't put it on. On this component, we need at least two. And here we need again at least two. You could put more points. Okay? So that's what I call C and N. So of course, you could call, you could number the, you can count 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on if you want. Okay, so that's a stable curve as defined by Dillin, Mumford, Knudsen. And the reason to have these three special points is, if you remember, that this implies that the automorphism group of C is finite. This was a necessary condition. I think I can now erase my travel agency. And we look at this stable curve. So whenever you have such a union of transversal curves, I think you guess already what is coming now. You may associate, define the augmented dual graph of Cn, and I call it C star n maybe. So how does this work? That's a standard construction, and I am sure you all know it. This is now a graph of graph theory. Each component, each irreducible component of C defines an inner vertex. Again, we will have inner and outer vertices, and they are connected. Vertices are connected if components intersect. And then you have to put labels, leaves, attach leaves with labels to the vertices according to the marked points on the component, according to the marked points on the respective component. Okay? So let me do it here. I think you guess already what is coming now. Difficult to hide it away. So we will get, maybe I call C, D, E, F, G, H, K, L, K, L, M. I don't know why I don't take I and J, but okay. So we get C, with one component we get a point. It intersects two, namely D and G. Now D, aside of intersecting C, it intersects also two more, namely E and F. And what about G? G will intersect also two more, namely H and K, but K will intersect again two more, namely L and M. You agree? And now we put the leaves. So C will have one marked point, so I put it here. D has no marked point, neither does G. E has three. F has also three. H has two. M has two, and L has two. And K has none. And of course, what you see is a phylogenetic tree. So lemma or proposition, C star is a phylogenetic tree. Okay. So that's one way to construct phylogenetic trees. And this is already, of course, the dual graph is known classically and studied. Yeah, but what is surprising that the properties of the phylogenetic trees were not used to deduce results about stable curves or about moduli spaces. And that's what we are going to do. Okay, so here's the proof is again by inspection. There's nothing deep behind, but it's nice. It's nice. So you see that the concept of stable curve is reflected by the properties of phylogenetic trees. I mean, That's like this. Yeah. So let's now go back to our concept of meeting point. So this is a remark. Meeting points Now you can go back from this one to this picture, meeting points of three leaves in phylogenetic tree of stable curve corresponds. Now this is an inner vertex, and as an inner vertex it corresponds to a component. Yeah? So it corresponds to what is called to the median component in C. So let me draw it here. Not very difficult. Maybe we take this marked point. Maybe it's too easy. This one and this one. So what is now the median component or the meeting component? Now if you go along these components, yeah, you move here, you approach until you end up in the same component. So the meeting component, I do it in maybe in red, is this here. It depends, of course, on the choice of the three leaves. Okay? And that will be relevant when we talk again about moduli spaces and phylogenetic trees. Stable curves. Sorry. So, two more remarks here. I hope you can still read. If C is irreducible, though if you just have one component, then you will get here just one inner vertex, then C star is generic. Recall, generic looked like this, just a number of leaves. And if components meet at most two others, sorry for the bad writing, then this implies that C star is a bamboo. Very easy to see. Okay? So, conclusion, whenever we have stable curves, we see phylogenetic trees behind. Okay? It's a very simple dictionary, but it justifies a little bit the consideration of phylogenetic trees. So, I think I will erase here everything. Take 1 minute of pause maybe, because now we want to associate another graph, but now to a string of n-gons. Of course, we did this already in detail in some examples, but now I want to do it rigorously with all details. So let me repeat. We will define for any string x, boldface x, in our set script yn, we define what we call the incidence graph. And then we will show that this incidence graph is again a phylogenetic tree. So next definition, excuse me. It's very hot inside here. So now go back to our world of strings. Let x equals xt, t in n choose 3, in yn inside p1, n choose 3, be a string of n-gons with equal cross ratios. And we already defined incident sets, it for each xt. Please look up at home the definition of this incident set. It collects the indices where the entries are the same. Okay? The incidence graph and I will rewrite it like this, of x has, now we have again inner vertices will be just the orbits xt of n-gons xt of x. Leaves I in n equals 1 up to n. And then we need the edges, and we only, yeah, so we need edges between the vertices. So v equals xt. W equals XS are connected by an edge. So this is now condition C, condition 2 from the lemma. If IT and IS share a complementary incident set, IJ equals N. Again, there is something in the chat. I will come back to it in a moment. And then we take IV is an edge. If V is S in 3 of the lemma, recall there's a unique, for each label I, there's a unique vertex. No, this was no good. I am not stuck. Sorry. We take an edge if the set I belongs to IV, singleton. Okay, and as I mentioned already several times, this incidence graph will be a phylogenetic tree. We will prove this later on, but I want to conclude today by doing examples to give you a feeling what's going on. Let me just check what is in the chat, if something important. Are they still talking discussing meeting points, so I can continue. Examples. And then we will finish for this year. I'm not able to do all. All examples I had prepared, but so for n equals 4, we just have 4 triples. So recall that we have the condition that the cross ratios are equal. So I don't take the generic case. The generic case is not so interesting. The non-generic. So x will be now xt, t in 1, 2, 3, 4 over 3. So we have x, 1, 2, 3, and recall we have the indices here, the labels indicate where we have 0, 1, and infinity. And then the last one, I will take it. As it is non-generic, you will take 1 of 0, 1, and infinity, and I will take just infinity up to permutation. That doesn't matter. Okay, so we have one repetition. Now x 1, 2, 4 will be, if you, I underline the 1, 2, 3. Now we have 1. It turns out that by the equality of cross ratio, this is 1, 2, 4. It must look like this, but x 1, 3, 4, it is now different. It will be 0, 0, 1, infinity, and now we have 3 and 4. Okay. So here, this is now what I said before. If the cross ratios of these two are equal, and you have equality here, then either the same entries are equal or the opposite ones. So that's just the complement of these here. And x 2, 3, 4 is again this one. 0, 0, 1, infinity, where now you have, I underline the indices which are in the superscript. Okay. So here the picture is quite easy. You just have two orbits. Yeah. The first two are the same, second two are the same, but they are not. The first two are not equivalent to the second one, so we get, here we have x 1, 2, 3, and the other one will be x 1, 3, 4, and so this one will have singletons 0 and 1, so this will be 1 and 2, because they are in place 1 and 2, 3 and 4. So that's the graph, and the generic one, I also draw it, it's just like this. That's the generic case. So of course, this is a unique phylogenetic tree, except this one with 4 leaves. So that's not very exciting. Now n equals 5 is already a lot of work. Okay, and we have now 10 5-gons in our string x. And I'm not, maybe I even write them down. The generic one will, for the generic one, it suffices that I just give the first one, x1, 2, 3, will be 0, 1, infinity. And then we are not allowed to have equality, so we have then, how do I write it, A and B, where A is different from B, and A, B are both in P1, but not 0, 1, and infinity. Okay. Let the generic string, and I just indicate the first n-gon, because all the other ones are precisely given already by this one. Now the limits. The limits are the boundary strings. And now, I think I invite you to do it a little bit on your own, because then you will first get the flavor, And second, for me, it was a new world how to fool around with these things. So I take an extreme case. I assume that A, now I take a limit as A and B move somewhere, no? And to simplify my life and to simplify the presentation, I just let A and B both go to infinity. Yes. So let me take x, 1, 2, 3 equals 0, 1, infinity, infinity, infinity. And again, I underline the places which correspond to my chosen triple. But now you will see that this, if you do the computation, we always use that the cross ratios are equal. This will be equal to x. Now I think my list is not complete, 1, 2, 4, and also x, 1, 2, 5. I spare you all the details, but you get another one which is interesting. You get x, 1, 3, 4. And this one now turns out to be 0, 0, 1, infinity, and then you have some c. And this c will be in p1, but not equal to 0, 1, and infinity. So that's surprising, no? But again, you see this complementary thing. Here the last three entries are equal, and here the first two are equal. And the value of c, you can then check that this is arbitrary, but it's not allowed to be equal one of these. Okay, so this, of course, defines a different orbit. So these two are not equivalent. Okay, and then we have another one. Where do I have it? Ba-ba-ba-ba-bum. No, sorry. We just have these. Yeah. And then stop. Now this was for C outside 0, 1, and infinity. But now we can take another limit, so we get two orbits. And the graph is simple. The first one has three here, and the other one. So this will correspond to the orbit x1, 2, 3, and this one to x1, 3, 4. I don't draw the other ones. And we will have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But now you may also take c going to infinity. That's another limit. And I will conclude with this one. I cannot. Next time after Christmas, I will give you more details on these examples. But for today, let's just have a glimpse of what's going on. So you see, there's now a bit of geometry inside. So in the generic one here, you see that A and B, they move in a two-dimensional variety. Now, down here, in this case, you still have 1 degree of freedom because C is allowed to move in P1 out at 0, 1, and infinity. Now, if you let C go to infinity, limit as C goes to infinity, and I have to abbreviate. I send you the list of all the n-gons separately because it doesn't make sense to write them here. Now, if you take here c equal to infinity, of course, this is up to permutation. You could also take 1. Then the following happens. Then you get, of course, you get again x1, 2, 3 as before. So this was 0, 1, infinity, 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 x, 1, 3, 4 is now 0, 0, 1, infinity, infinity, 0, 1, 4. But we get a new one, which is, one, four, five, x. Of course, some of the other n-gons may be equivalent or even equal. I don't write them down. X 1 4 5 will be. That's now new. 0 0. You have 3 zeros. You can check it. I made a lot of mistakes. 1 and infinity. So here you have 1 4 and 5. And now you see that these three n-gons, five gons, they are not equivalent. So you get three orbits. Excuse me? Three orbits. And now you can draw the graph. What is the incidence graph? So x1, 2, 3 and x1, 4, 5 are some kind of symmetric to each other. You just exchange the values and the positions. But x1, 3, 4 is different. And x1, 3, 4 has the following property. It shares complementary sets with both, with x1, 2, 3 and x1, 4. Here, the first two entries are equal, and here the last three are equal. And if you take these last two entries, you have three complementary here. So the graph will be the following. You have x, 1, 3, 4 in the middle, and you will have, here you will have x, 1, 2, 3. Here you will have x, 1, 4, 5. Okay. You have three inner vertices corresponding to the three orbits. And one, what is the singleton of 1, 3, 4? It is 1. That's the only one which is alone. So this is number 3. And x1, 2, 3, it has two singletons, 0 and 1, at first and second place. So you have 1 and 2. And the last three entries are equal because they are in the same travel destination. Okay, so you get this tree which we have already seen much earlier. Okay, I like it, and I hope you like it too. And I wish you Merry Christmas and all the best for the next year. And I'll be happy if we meet again on January 9th or something like this. In any case, I'll try to send you here the details for these computations. Stay safe, and thank you for joining me in this adventure. Bye-bye, and Merry Christmas. Bye-bye.
Merry Christmas. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, teacher.